Hello, Bee here, and welcome back to biology. Chances are you have seen this graph before. It shows the human population from the year 10,000 BCE to 2020. Most likely you've probably also heard how the human population is growing too quickly for Earth to sustain. However, it is not all bad news. In fact, scientists predict that the population growth will slow considerably by the year 2100. In this lesson, we will look at population growth in general, as well as human population growth. But before we get started, let's look at our goals for this lesson. By the end, you'll be able to identify and discuss the factors that affect population growth, analyze population graphs for changes in population sizes, explain the concept of carrying capacity and its relationship to population growth. From a biological perspective, a population is a group of organisms of the same species that all live together in the same area. The catfish that live in a lake make up a population because they are geographically isolated from catfish that live in other lakes. This is an example of an environmental boundary of a population. Sometimes populations are defined by arbitrary boundaries so that they can be studied. An example of this could be the population of the people living in a town. There is no physical boundary separating this population from the people in the next town. However, it is a way for the population to be studied and analyzed. When studying and discussing populations, there are a few characteristics that ecologists use. Two important ones are population density and spatial distribution. Did you know that the most densely populated city in the world is Manila in the Philippines? The population is approximately 119,600 people per square mile. Let's compare that to Anchorage, Alaska, whose population density is approximately 170 people per square mile. That's a big difference. Population density is the number of organisms in a particular area and can tell scientists a lot about a population. If measured at regular intervals, it can show a rise or fall in population without having to count every animal. It can also tell what type of lifestyle a particular animal prefers, such as solitary species like tigers or colonial species like rabbits. Scientists can also use these numbers to analyze the availability of natural resources, because population density tends to be higher near natural resources like food and water. Spatial distribution is the spacing of a population within an area. There are three patterns for populations: clumped, uniform, and random. Clumped spacing is when individuals are clustered together. This is usually due to social behavior and access to resources. Uniform distribution is when individuals are equally spaced out. For example, gannet birds try to stay far away from each other so that they can defend their nests against other birds in the population. The final distribution, random, is when there is no pattern to their location. This is very rare. Population limiting factors are factors that can limit a population's growth. They can be density dependent factors or density independent factors. Limiting factors that are density dependent are those that depend on the number of members of a population per unit area. They are often biotic, meaning they are caused by living things. Some examples might be predators, disease, parasites, competition, and access to food. If you look closely at the graph of human population growth, you will notice a small dip in the graph before it begins to grow exponentially. This represents the presence of a density-dependent limiting factor, the bubonic plague. During the 1300s, it is estimated that the bubonic plague, or Black Death, killed an estimated 100 to 200 million people. Density-independent factors are abiotic, or not caused by living things, and include natural phenomena like weather events, floods, hurricanes, and forest fires, as well as human changes to the environment and pollution. An example would be the animals that live in the trees that burn down during forest fires in California and the Pacific Northwest each summer. Imagine you are the manager of a retail store. You want to make sure that your store isn't empty, but also that it isn't overcrowded, making it difficult for customers to shop. One way to know how many people are in the store and how many customers you are gaining is to have someone stand at the door and count who enters and who leaves. If more people enter than leave, your customer number is increasing. But if more people leave than enter, your customer number is declining. This is the same method ecologists use to determine population growth. Population growth explains how quickly a population is growing or shrinking. To determine population growth, ecologists add the births and immigration, which is the number of individuals moving into a population, and subtract the number of deaths and emigration, or the number of individuals leaving a population. In many cases, the immigration and emigration numbers are almost the same, so ecologists often focus on just the birth and death rates. If a population is growing, the growth rate is positive, and if the population is declining, the growth rate is negative. When modeling growth rate, it usually will follow one of two models, the exponential growth model or the logistic growth model. The exponential growth model occurs when the growth increases at the same rate forever, without any limiting factors in place. The growth of the human population follows an exponential growth model. Logistic growth models are more common. In these models, a population grows exponentially, but then slows or stops altogether when it hits its carrying capacity. The carrying capacity of a population is the maximum number of individuals in a population that the environment can support long-term due to limited amounts of energy, water, nutrients, etc. Carrying capacity is the reason most populations are able to stabilize over time. For most of human history, the population of the world was below 1 billion people. Today, it is estimated to be close to 8 billion people. Think back to your history lessons. What changed that allowed our population to grow so quickly? The Industrial Revolution in the early 1800s brought with it an increase in sanitation and healthcare, among other things, that allowed people to live longer, causing a dramatic increase in population, and the human population continued to grow exponentially as medicine and other technological advancements continued to increase life expectancy. While the graph we just looked at is helpful, it only shows us one snapshot of human population numbers, the population of the entire world at a given time. Sometimes it is helpful to look at the population of specific countries and regions, or the population broken down by age. When looking at those populations, ecologists use age structure diagrams. Here are some examples of age structure diagrams, sometimes called age pyramids. Their shapes tell you about the growth of a population. The diagram on the left shows slow population growth because, although there are more younger members of the population, the increase between older and younger members is small, so there won't be a large change in overall population over time. This is in contrast to the middle diagram. In this diagram, there is a huge difference in the number of young members of the population and older members of the population. This means that there are more younger people being born and growing up than older individuals dying. In the diagram on the right, there is no growth in the population because the number of older members and younger members are about equal. As we went through the lesson today, we identified and discussed different factors that affect population growth and learned how ecologists study populations. In our last and final lesson in this unit and this class... Wait, what? We are finished with biology? Wow, that was fast! In our last and final lesson, we will look at sustainability and what humans can do to make the Earth an even better place, both close to home and in the wider world. Until next time, remember that biology isn't just science. It's the way of life. See you next time. Hey, hey.